if you're not very familiar with working with a GitHub repo, well, what you can, the material that I have available for you here, so the data sets, the scripts, the sheets, etc. So you can download everything that is over here by using this green button. And if you click on it, you can do download zip. And then you will be able to download the data sets, the scripts as a zip file. And if you then unpack this zip file and store it somewhere on your computer, then you should be able to get the data sets and the scripts, right? So I think I forgot to mention that, and I'm sorry if this created a bit of confusion, but that's the way how you can get this material that is stored over here, right? So that's only necessary if you're working with a local version of R and if you wanna have the data sets on your own system and look at the scripts on your own machine. All right, so that being said, I'm gonna continue with my lecture sheets, right? And I think I'm gonna pick it up from here, right? Which is about the maximum likelihood estimation. So we're in the part on claim frequencies. And we already discussed that if we wanna do maximum likelihood estimation on an actual data set, then we're gonna write a function. And that function sort of creates the negative of the log likelihood as a function of unknown parameters. And what we're going to do then is we're going to take a numerical optimization routine, a minimization routine, and ask the software to minimize this negative log likelihood. So that means the software is going to search for the parameter values which are minimizing this function that we programmed, right? And we already applied that to the Poisson setting. So we saw a couple of ways to do that with Poisson. And one of the, we covered three strategies, let's say. We can do it with the fit dist, where you just say, okay, fit this particular distribution to this outcome, the number of claims in this case. The problem with that is that you cannot build in the exposure, for example, in the structure that you propose for the expected claim frequency. So that was one strategy. Then the second strategy was to go for the built-in routine called GLM, generalized linear models in R. And there you have to think more in a kind of regression style. So that means you've got a target variable, you do tilde, and then you're supposed to list the covariates that you want to include in your linear predictor. So here we're basically ignoring the covariates because the only thing we're interested in is building a claim frequency distribution. So that's why I only have this one, which means I calibrate the intercept, right? And I build up this explanation a little bit over here. But then we said, yeah, be careful. If you do it like this, you're ignoring the exposure again. So if you want to build in the exposure, you're going to include a term in your predictor, which is called in statistics an offset. So that means it's part of your linear predictor. But the associated regression parameter is put exactly equal to one. So that means that you don't calibrate a beta, a regression parameter for this particular covariate. So you get a structure like this for the logarithm of the mean, so the logarithm of the expected outcome. So if you transform that, you get the following expression for the expected claim frequency y. So it's the exposure times the exponential of the intercept. And we already mentioned that that is a clever way to do it because it allows you to build in exposure. That's one good thing. You make the expected number of claims proportional to the exposure of the policyholder. But on the other hand, you also avoid in that way to do any constraint optimization. And what do I mean with that? Well, the lambda in a Poisson model should be positive. Right, so that means if we want to estimate this lambda, we cannot estimate it freely. We need to force it to be positive. And a clever way to do that is to bring in this exponential function. So not to calibrate the lambda directly, but to calibrate the beta zero in this notation and specifying it or building in this exponential transformation so that the corresponding expected annual claim frequency for sure will be positive by using this exponential function. Yeah? So that's a clever way to do it. And then as a third and last option, we said, yeah, but What if you want to write this function yourself and take care of the optimization yourself? So in that case, you're going to write a function for the negative log likelihood. You're going to feed this function to a nonlinear minimization routine. You're going to give starting values for the parameters. You're going to ask the routine to evaluate the Hessian numerically. So that means it's going to evaluate the matrix with the second order derivatives of the, in this case, of the negative log likelihood. And you're going to give certain arguments to this function. So these are basically observed quantities that we need to use to build up the likelihood. So today we're going to continue on this idea, programming the negative log likelihood ourselves. And the interesting thing here is that, of course, if you master this kind of this way of thinking, then you can also use it when you need to calibrate more exotic models, right? So if you think about the splice distribution, for example, or if you think about the mixture of airlines or something which is not directly available in R, well, there you have to program things yourself, and then it's good that you master this kind of reason, right? So that's why I show it here. So what we're gonna do now is we're gonna switch to the negative binomial. So we're gonna think about the negative binomial as the next example, and we're gonna fit the negative binomial distribution, which is a distribution with two parameters. We're going to fit that to the dataset MTPL, and we're going to focus on the number of claims in this dataset. And again, I'm going to do that in two ways. I'm going to use the built-in function, which is the equivalent of the GLM function that we encountered before, but now allows us to use a negative binomial likelihood. So that's going to be the GLM.nb, which is part of the mass library, right? So there is a built-in regression style function that allows us to do negative binomial regression. So we're going to use that function. We're again modeling the number of claims. We're only bringing in an intercept, and we do include as an offset the log of exposure. Again, we use as the link function the logarithmic link function. We use as the dataset the MTPL dataset. So I know that for students who have no background on GLMs, the fact that I'm using here a link function is very strange, right? But what we're doing is exactly what I explained on one of the previous sheets. We're not building the regression model directly for the expected value of the target. We're building this regression structure for a transformation of the expected value of the target. And that transformation, that's what we call here the link function. So we built the regression structure with this intercept and with this log of exposure as the offset. We're building that for the logarithm of the expected number of claims. And we do that such that the expected number of claims can then be written as the exponential of the logarithm of exposure times the exponential of my intercept. And that boils down to the specification. It's exposure times the exponential of the intercept. Yeah. And here you see again the output. So you see that I get the estimate for my intercept, but I also get an additional estimate, of course, because my negative binomial is now a two-parameter distribution. So I get an additional parameter. I denote it here with R, but sometimes it's denoted with phi or whatever. So you find the additional parameter estimate over here and its corresponding standard error. Yeah. So if you type summary of the object that we create as such, so the frec GLM NB, where I store my results in, you'll see that you get this estimate for the intercept, you get the standard error. And if you would scroll down a little bit, the code was, or the output was too long, you see, I know I've got it here. So the dispersion parameter for our negative binomial is mentioned over here. That's the 1.4. We also got an AIC value printed over here. I'm gonna come back to that later on, yeah? But now, of course, what if we would have to do this ourselves, right? So in an ambitious moment, I thought it would be a great exercise for you to do with some live coding. So let me just give you an introduction to the solution, and then I'll give you some time to look at the code yourself in R, right? So what do we want to do? Starting from the handcrafted Poisson likelihood and its numerical optimization, Can we now do something similar for the negative binomial? And if we do so, can we then match the estimates, the standard errors that we retrieve with our own do-it-yourself approach? Can we match those outcomes with the output that we got from this built-in function for the negative binomial, right? So here is my approach to the solution. And so what I will ask you to do is, I guess you can either type these instructions yourself or just copy-paste the code into your R script and play a little bit with it. But the essential idea is to get a bit of a feeling about how we would do this. So we would create again a function, and this function is going to calculate the negative log likelihood of the negative binomial distribution for us. So this function relies on unknown parameters, here called par, and it also relies on some arguments which we observe in the data set, which we're going to pass on to this function. So one of the striking things here is that the par is now two-dimensional, because the negative binomial is a parametric distribution using two parameters. One parameter will take care of the so-called the mu, the mean, and another parameter will take care of this so-called dispersion parameter, here abbreviated with R. And both have to be positive. So I'm again doing my clever trick by saying I'm going to estimate par 1 and par 2. So these are first and second entry in my vector of parameters par. And I'm going to take the exponential transformation. For the mean, I'm going to multiply with the observed exposure. For the dispersion parameter, I just leave it as is. And then I know that I'm always ending up, at the end of the day, I will always end up with positive values for my calibrated parameters. So that's my clever trick over here. So what do I need to do here? You don't have to program this likelihood of the negative binomial or this probability function underneath the negative binomial. You don't have to program that yourself. And for a lot of distributions, we've got that built-in in R, and it's way more efficient if you're going to use these built-in implementations. So here we're going to rely on dn by nom. So d is for density, or in our case, probability function, because it's a discrete distribution. And the n by nom, that refers to the negative binomial. And we want to evaluate this probability function in the observed claim frequency. So that's the argument that I'm passing on to my function. And be careful, R is thinking in a vectorized way. So the vector frec, that will be the vector from my MTPL dataset where I have all these claim counts. So if I pass that on to the function, the density of the negative binomial, it's going to be a vector of probabilities evaluated, the probability to observe k claims, where this k runs, from the first number of claims for the first policyholder to the last one in my data set. So it's a vectorized way of thinking, right? We pass on the arguments that are used in this negative binomial probability function. So that's the mu and r used in the appropriate way. You have to check the help for the implementation of this density function to be sure. And we calculate these probabilities at log scale. Again, because we want to, in the end, have the negative log likelihood, and it's more efficient if I directly ask the d by n by nom function to calculate the probability at the log scale. I'm going to take the sum of the elements in this vector, because it's a vectorized way of working, so I'll get here a vector with probabilities. So I take the sum of all these log probabilities, I put a minus in front, and that's my negative log likelihood. And then I'm calling again my NLM routine. I give starting values, and here it really doesn't matter much what the starting values are. With more complex distributions, this really may matter, especially if you look at severity distributions. And then my advice is to initialize the parameter estimates by thinking or by referring to moment estimators, right? Because if you can give the moment estimator of your parameter, and if you can get a clever initialization there, that will make your life way more easier for the more complex distribution. So here it doesn't matter much. I calculate the Hessian. I say, okay, what are you going to use for the frec? You're going to use the observed number of claims. What are you going to use for the exposure? The observed exposures as stored in this vector, MTPL dollar sign expo- We do the optimization. We're going to inspect our results. And of course, the parameters that you get over here, these are the parameter estimates for this part one and part two, right? So you still need to take the exponential if you want to be able to compare your parameter estimates with the estimates that you have in mind for the lambda and the estimate that you have in mind for the dispersion parameter as printed by this GLM routine before, right? So what we see over here is that the lambda value that we get is perfectly in line with what we empirically calculated before. So it's really the same value as the empirical expected claim frequency, taking into account exposure. If we look at the value of our dispersion parameter, 1.43, it's exactly the value that I retrieved in the GLM output before. If I want to see the standard errors, and be careful, these are the standard errors that correspond to the part one and part two values, right? Because at that level, I calculated my parameters. So the Hessian will lead me to standard errors that correspond to the values that I retrieved over here, right? So if I want to translate that into standard errors for lambda and for the dispersion parameter on their original scale, then I need to do the delta method. Yeah, that would be a next step. So I think it's nice to check these standard errors and to compare them with what we had before. And you can only compare it with the one over here, because that's a standard error that comes with the intercept. For the dispersion parameter, we have the standard error at the level of the dispersion parameter. So I can only retrieve this value if I would apply the delta method to the value that I obtained over here. So that could be a nice check, which I didn't include here, but that would be the connection. Yeah. If I would get the variance estimated by this negative binomial model, then I would look at the theoretical expression for the variance. So the theoretical expression for the variance in the negative binomial would be mu plus mu squared divided by r. So that's what I calculate here, and that turns out to be very close to the empirical variance that we calculated earlier on, right? So before switching to R, maybe let me add a few ideas on model selection and evaluation tools. So how can you now, so you fitted the Poisson, you fitted the negative binomial distribution to this data set. How can we compare the results? Well, one of the criteria that we can use is an information criterion like the AIC. And what the AIC is going to do, it's going to balance a goodness of fit criterion, which is here expressed by -2 times the log likelihood. We want to make that as small as possible, right? And we're going to add to that a penalty for complexity. And the penalty in this case is 2 times the number of parameters that we calibrated. So that if you achieve more or less the same value for -2 times the log likelihood, but for one model, you need a small number of parameters, and for another model, you really need a lot of parameters, then the AIC is going to prefer the model that is more simple, right? So with this AIC, the idea is that we can compare models based on their values reached for the AIC, and that we prefer the model that leads us to the smallest number for the AIC, because that's a model that is good at balancing the goodness of fit expressed by -2 times the log likelihood and the complexity of the model, which is expressed here by 2 times the number of parameters that my model is using. So I calculated the AICs here myself. I put the two AICs next to each other. I prefer the one that leads to the smallest AIC. So in this case, the negative binomial model fit would be preferred. So even though the negative binomial is more complex than the Poisson, because it uses 2 parameters instead of just one, the improved goodness of fit, so the improved value for -2 times the log likelihood is so substantial that this extra parameter that the negative binomial is using is justified. So even if we include this penalty for the extra parameter, then still we reach a lower value for the AIC with the negative binomial. Okay, so the inclusion of this penalty, it's really there to avoid overfitting, Because if you would go for more complex and more complex models, if you would add additional parameters, if you work in a parametric structure, then you would also always be able to bring down this negative log likelihood. So we want to avoid that. So that's why we take this penalty for complexity into account, right? And then a last check that I also build in is, what if we look at the observed and the fitted claim count distributions? I think this is a nice one. We explained it from time to time, I think, in the lecture sheets. But of course, you here have an observed claim count distribution, right? And you can easily calculate that. You just calculate how often did one of my policyholders report zero claims? How many observations did report one claim, two claims, and so on? So that's this sum that I have over here. So I'm just going to count in my data set how many policyholders, zero claims, one claims, two claims, etc. And I do it here with a for loop. You just have to be careful. The for loop starts or uses an index I running from 1 to 5. But of course, I want to start with evaluating how many people reported zero claims, right? So that's why I put as a first entry in my vector observed count, I just put the number of policyholders who reported zero claims. So n claims equal to zero, right? And then I'm going to compare that. And I'm going to compare that to, what would be expected under the fitted negative binomial model. And then we already derived in the lectures that what you need to do for that is you need to calculate what would be the expected number of people, in my data set, in my initial group of 163,000 and so on policyholders, who would report zero claims. And what we need to do for that is we need to sum the probability to see zero claims in my fitted negative binomial model. And the reason for that is we're in fact working with an indicator variable. We need to take a sum of indicator variables. And this indicator variable will take a value of 1. If the policyholder reports zero claims, we'll take a value of 1 for the next line if he will report one claim, and so on. So you're working with a sum of indicator variables. The expected value of the indicator variable is the probability of success. So that's the probability to report zero claims under the fitted negative binomial. And then we just have to be careful, this fitted negative binomial, how are we going to work with that? So the way how I did it here is I went back to the GLM fit of the negative binomial. And there I called the fitted values of this GLM. And the reason why I do that is because then I automatically have the exposure taken into account. If I would have to program that myself, I would need to be careful to multiply the vector with the exposures, with the exponential of the fitted, the first fitted parameter in my negative binomial. Yeah, so the bottom line here is be careful, take the exposure into account when you're calculating these probabilities to observe zero claims, one claim, etc. So what you can then do is you can come up with a table like this where you see the frequency, so the number of claims, where you see how many observations you had reporting zero claims, and where you also have your model-based count. So one of the evaluation tools that you can use is, does my fitted model give me a model-based count that is close to what I actually observed in the data, right? And of course, as an exercise, you could try to adjust this code and do this yourself for the Poisson distribution. All right. So that's a little bit what I put together for the negative binomial. We have one additional example where we do a zero inflated model. So let us first take a bit of time to go to the code and to try to make sense out of this. So I'm in the script day one participants. I'm first of all going to reload my data to make sure that I've got it available. So I load the packages I want to use. So that's the library Tidyverse. And like we discussed last Tuesday, we're going to work with the PC data, so the MTPL data set. So we're going to do this little trick with the RStudio API to get the path of the file, the R script that we're working with. We're going to load the data set. We're going to store it as a tuple. We can inspect this data set. We can inspect the first rows. And then I'm going to do my change to lowercase and rename the exposure variable. So if you briefly repeat these instructions, you should now have the MTPL dataset at your disposal in your R system. And you should see here, okay, you should recognize the structure of the dataset as we explained it before, right? It's also nice if you run this, maybe this color, this cool BG color, this cool blue and green. I'm not sure if I'm going to use it today, but it's good to have that available as well. So I'll put it in the chat in case you're looking for the specification of this color. And maybe just to be sure, it's also good if we load the SecureArray dataset so that we've got it available as well, right? So what I'm then going to do is if you scroll down to here, for me it's on line 172, but it's probably going to be different in your script due to comments that we may have added, etc. So let's try the negative binomial distribution. Let's try to get that working, right? And